今天那个谢谢 Michael， 他远从美国来台湾跟大家分享这一个 topic， 不用担心他讲中文，所以大家不用担心说还要再烦恼英文的事情。好，那 Michael 本身其实还蛮厉害的，他之前在梦工厂，大家都知道梦工厂，那他参与的 project 的电影包含有史瑞克三啊四，然后还有寻龙高手、功夫panda。
所以这些就是大家不断能够耳熟能详的东西。那希望大家会喜欢今天的那个讨论。好，大家好。虽然我会讲国语，但是讲的不太流利，所以等一下这个是讲英文的。OK, hi everybody, Michael M. I'm the CEO of Nephosity, and I'm here today to talk to you about open source, mobile, cloud, and medical images. 不好意思，我可以先用那个吗？哦，那用我来这边。OK, so the synopsis of my talk is going to be as follows. I'm going to go over what we're building and try to explain the problem that we're trying to solve. Then I'm going to give a demo of what the product actually is. And then after the demo, it's just going to be a video. And then after that, I'll go into the explanation of why we use open source and then a list and provide a list of the open source packages that we use. Okay, so what are we building? Simply put, it's a mobile collaboration ecosystem for medical images. And the problem that we're trying to solve is that current workflows involving medical images are cumbersome and non-collaborative. And what do I mean by cumbersome and non-collaborative? Well, here's an example. Let's say you were to go get an MRI or an X-ray. Right, and you get this X-ray or MRI from an imaging center, and then they give you a CD of your MRI or X-ray. And then you take the CD to your doctor, and then the doctor says, okay, let me load up the CD. So he loads up the CD, and then after a while, the picture of you pops up on the screen. Okay. So what's the problem with this case? It's cumbersome, right? Why is it cumbersome? Because it takes 10 to 15 minutes to load your MRI or X-ray or whatever images that you have. And imagine when a doctor that specializes in reading these images, he has to do this 20 to 30 times a day. So it's actually a lot of time wasted on the doctor's behalf. Okay, example two shows what I mean by it's non-collaborative. So in this case, you have, let's say you're in Boston and you have a doctor and you're going to go get surgery, right? So your doctor says, all right, I need to consult a specialist, but this specialist is in Los Angeles. So he calls up this doctor in Los Angeles and the doctor says, well, send me the X-ray, right? Because the doctor in Los Angeles does not have access to the hospital in Boston, the doctor in Boston has to send the X-ray via CE to Los Angeles, right? And then now, and then so the CE is sent, a few days later, they get on the phone and they talk. So it works, right? It is what people are doing now, but it's not collaborative. And what I mean by not collaborative, well, first of all, it's still cumbersome because you have to send the CD. And what I mean by non collaborative is that when they're talking on the phone, the doctors aren't, they do not get to see what each other is looking at, right? They sort of just talk about it, and they don't actually see what's happening on the other side. So our solution to these two problems is to build a mobile collaboration ecosystem that eliminates friction in viewing and collaborating with medical images. And this system has two main components. One we call it nephosCT, and that's the cloud server backend. And it supports collaboration and delivers the medical images in real time. And then we have mobileCT, and that's the mobile collaborative teleradiology app. And you can, it's for your iPad, and allows you to view and collaborate on your iPad. Okay, so I have a demo of the video, or a video of the demo. Before I start it, does anyone have any questions so far? Great. Okay, so bear with me while I pull up the video.
Let's see.
I need to sound right.
In mobile devices, to do x-rays, MRIs, and to collaborate with other users such as other doctors or relatives. This is made possible by two key components, this mobile medical image viewer and a cloud-enabled collaboration platform. The viewer has an intuitive user interface with features designed in collaboration with radiologists. Using one finger, a user can adjust the window level and width, doctor speak for image calibration, and two fingers to pan and zoom. The image viewer supports full resolution x-rays. Image detail is not compromised by using the mobile app. A user can also scroll through image layers by simply dragging the finger along the slider. When it is time to collaborate with another doctor or patient, simply create a collaborative session. And the other user can join it using the session password. The second user's screen is immediately synced up to what the first user sees. Navigation and image calibration works as before, and changes immediately reflected on the second user's screen. The shared cursor feature highlights an area of interest, and annotations are immediately synced up across to the other user. Finally, the second user can request control for the session. The second user now has control, and any changes made is reflected on the first user's screen. Please contact us at hello@nephosity.com with any feedback or inquiries. We look forward to hearing from you.
Okay. So that was the video of the demo. I'm going to keep going, but before I do, does anyone have any questions so far?
Can the two users talk to each other online when they...
You mean using like something, so using audio through the like, not yet. We haven't implemented that yet because there are so many competing technologies right now, like FaceTime and Skype and Freeing and all, you know, all these, and we're still trying to evaluate what's the best one to use. Because what's going to happen is that we don't want to develop the technology ourselves, right? That's partly why we use open source, and we want to use someone else's SDK. But in order to do that, like if they were to use Skype, that means every user has to have a Skype account. So we're trying to figure out how we can get it so that every user who's in our system has, for example, a Skype account. Any other questions in the meantime? Okay, so let's continue. Okay, so this is a picture of an overview of the system design. And what you see here is sort of the possible ways that you can use our platform. On the right side, the top right side, you have a desktop computer, and to it you can connect your laptop. So we actually have a consumer version for your home that you can download a server onto your computer and then connect your iPad to that computer, and you can download images onto your iPad. And this solves the problem in example one, where we talk about things being cumbersome, right? Because once you've downloaded the images on your iPad, you can take it around. You can, for example, if you were to go to see your doctor, you can show your doctor immediately. Your doctor doesn't have to wait 15 minutes, right, to load up, to view your images. The other thing that you can do is you can also show your friends, right? I know, for example, one thing that people like to do when they're having a baby is to show the baby's ultrasound. Right. So now imagine you can just, rather than carrying out a picture, you can carry around the entire video of the ultrasound itself. Okay. So on the left side is our cloud service, right? I mentioned earlier, we call it nephosCT. And to it, you can connect a bunch of iPads, a bunch of mobile CTs, if you will. And then through the cloud, you can download the images in real time and then also do collaboration among multiple devices. Okay, so we built this entire system using a lot of open source. Okay, and you'll see how much open source we use later. But the question is, why do we use open source? Well, we really don't know that much. Okay, so people who develop open source, we think, know a lot more than we do and understand problems better than we do. We're really not that smart. Right. People who build open source, they're really smart and come up with better solutions. We're kind of lazy. Why do something if someone else has already done it? Right. And we're kind of busy too, because Angry Birds is very time consuming. Okay, so we use open source for those four reasons, but why? How do we use open source? Well, we use open source in our product. We have, I've mentioned now three of our products, the desktop server, the cloud server, and mobile app, and they are built using a lot of open source. We also use open source for our own productivity, so that includes our developer tools are open source, our project management software is open source, our quality assurance tools are open source, and so are our packaging tools. Okay, and so now here is the list, a very long list, but it's still non-comprehensive, of the packages that we use. First up, the GUI packages. We use Qt and ClientSide and 320. Qt is a C++ GUI library, and PySide is the Python bindings for Qt. And these two libraries are developed by Nokia. They're licensed under LGPL, and we use them to build the cross-platform GUI for desktop server. 320 is a UI library for iOS devices, and it was originally developed by Facebook and licensed under Apache, and we use it to build the GUI for our iPad app. For our cloud service, we use Eucalyptus, Mongrel 2, and Celery. Eucalyptus is an IaaS software. It's the open source equivalent of Amazon's EC2. So for those of you who have used Amazon's cloud computing service, you know, you can pretty much just switch the URL to Eucalyptus, and it works exactly the same way. It's developed by Eucalyptus Systems, licensed under GPL, and we use it to deploy private clouds. Mongrel 2 is a language-agnostic web server. What that means is you have handlers in the back end that actually basically take requests forwarded by Mongrel 2 and handles them, so your handlers in the back end can be written in any language. It's developed by Zed Shaw. Zed Shaw also developed Mongrel, which is a very popular Ruby Rails web server. Mongrel 2 is licensed under BSD, and we use this as our gatekeeper to our cloud. Celery is a distributed task queuing system. It was originally developed by Django, and it's used a lot by Django for a lot of backend processing, but now it's a separate package that you can use. It's BSD licensed, and we use it to pull and manage tasks to process the medical images that are uploaded to our cloud. Okay, for messaging, we use RabbitMQ, 0MQ, UDT, and 0Conf. RabbitMQ is a brokered messaging with persistence. It's developed by Springsource, which is owned by VMware. It's Mozilla public license, and we use it mainly for the Celery, because Celery uses it as a its messaging backend. ZeroMQ is a super fast brokerless messaging library. It's developed by Mimatics. It's under the LGPL, and we use it for the messaging backend for our mobile device, for Mongrel 2, and also the various cloud components to talk to each other. UDT is called UDP-based data transfer. It's developed by Yonghong Wu. He's the main developer on Sector Sphere. UDT is BSD licensed, and UDT is actually used by Sector FS for high bandwidth transfer, and I'll talk about, a little bit about Sector FS in a little bit. ZeroConf is a spec for zero configuration for devices to connect to each other. It was, ZeroConf was written by Apple, and so Apple implemented ZeroConf as Bonjour and released it as open source under the Apple public source license. The people then, you know, open source developers took the ZeroConf spec as well as Bonjour and took a look at it and implemented an open source version of ZeroConf for other Unix and BSD systems called Vahi, and that's under LGPL. And then on top of either Bonjour or Vahi, you have PyBonjour, which is a Python wrapper to the ZeroConf library, and that's under the MIT license. And we use this so that users connecting to either the desktop server or an internal cloud does not have to do configuration. Okay, for DICOM, DICOM is a short term for Digital Imaging and Communications in Medicine. It is a standard for handling, storing, printing, and transmitting information in medical images. It includes a file format definition and a network communication protocol. And we, because of these two things, we actually use two different libraries, GDCM and DCM for CHIP. GDCM is a library for reading and writing DICOM images. It currently has no network capabilities and handles only the file format portion of the DICOM standard. And it was developed by a guy named Mathieu Malater, and it's under the BSD license, and you know, we use it to read medical images. DCM4CHE is an open source clinical image and object management platform. The foundation is called DCM4CHE.org. It's triple license, so you can choose the MPL, GPL, or LGPL to use. And we use it as our network library, the DICOM network library, so that we can download DICOM files from hospital PACS. PACS is the picture archiving communication system that hospitals use to store the images. And so we use it to download the PACS store cloud, from the PACS store cloud. For data distribution, we have SectorFS, MongoDB, and S2Lite. SectorFS is a super fast fault-tolerant distributed file system. It was developed by the NCDM at the University of Illinois. Its main developer is Yonghong Wu, who I mentioned earlier. SectorFS is licensed under Apache 2.0, and we use SectorFS to distribute and replicate large files, i.e. the DICOM images across our cloud. MongoDB is a distributed NoSQL database. It's developed by Tengen. It's licensed under AGPL license for the database itself, but for the drivers, it's Apache license. We use it to replicate image data across our cloud. And then there's S2Lite. S2Lite is an embedded SQL database developed by a company called Huasi. The source code is actually in the public domain, and we use it for configuration and metadata caching. It's also used by a Mongo 2 for configuration. So, other packages in our source code include SVJSON, that's an Objective-C JSON library, MexReaction, which is an event processing in Python, Keradet, language detection, because DICOMs have from different countries use different languages, and so we use it to detect which language actually is embedded in a DICOM, and thread pool, which is for pulling up threads. Okay, so those were all the packages, or the most of the packages, that open source packages that we use in our products. And then here are some of the ones that we use to be productive. So we use Subversion for our version control. We use Nose for unit testing in Python. We use Coverage, that's developed by Ned Batchelor, for test coverage in Python. We use Track for project management. We use Pi Installer. It's a multi-platform packaging for a desktop server. It's great. You say Pi Installer, whatever, and it builds both the Windows, Mac, and Linux binary sort. And then we use Inno Setup. So once the Windows binary has been packaged, we use Inno Setup to build the installer package for them. Of course, we don't just use open source. We also contribute back to open source. We have written a few libraries, and then we also, and these include PalmSets, which is workflow management. I actually gave a talk here last year on PalmSets, so if you were there, we might remember the talk or not, or you can look it up on the internet. Cloud Pool, which is an execution pool that you can run in your cloud. Pi Patterns, some common programming patterns in Python. And curry pi allows for serialization and deserialization of curried objects. And then also we provide patches to open source projects that are used. So you asked anything else? That was pretty long. And the truth is, yeah, there's a lot that I haven't listed. But a big part of it is that the ones that I have listed is that we are still investing in new technologies, new open source packages. Like earlier when we were talking about the question about audio and as well as video, we're still investigating that, so I didn't list them here. So the summary of my talk is that we are building mobile collaboration for medical images, and you know, this field has a really bright future. It has all the latest buzzwords: mobile, collaboration, medical, cloud. And we think our product really has potential out there. I hope that's not me. And we're doing it using a lot of open source, plus a little bit of our secret sauce. But we do contribute some of that secret sauce back to open source. And I feel like this guy here, the secret ingredient. Okay. In summary, finally, if you have any medical images, buy our app. It's on the App Store. You can go to our website and check it out. And then the plan is to release the cloud service, the beta version of it in Q1 2012. Probably in Q4, but I'm saying Q1 just to be safe, so you don't call me a liar later. Okay, so that's it. Any questions?
How many people work on your team?
Our company, there's only two of us right now.
Yeah. Oh. Only two?
Yes.
As a founder and developer
That's what you do as a founder, you do everything.
And what else do you?
I'm also the chauffeur, the janitor, the cook.
Other questions?
There's one back there.
Okay.
因为医院他们自己里面他的 network 都已经 secure 了， 所以我们其实不用担心太多。到最后是我的 cloud service 的话，那是到那时候就需要那个，就是需要做的比较稳定一点。
What's the most frequently asked question that when you are trying to sell, that you ask the most when you try to sell your eggs to your husband?
I think the question is, can it also do X? And X is something that we haven't done. So our answer is always no. But it's coming, so. I'm sorry.
What is your principle if you want to develop some feature and you choose?
I see. Okay. Well, generally we look at how well we, because ours is, and as you probably know, this ours is a C++ Python stack. So generally it has to be either in C, C++, or Python. And then if it's in C++, we'll write the Python bindings. We have to make sure that it can scale up. So we do a lot of stress testing of our packages to make sure that it will scale up. Like, you know, and for example, it has to be multi-threaded or multi-processed. It has to not have certain dependencies. Yeah.
Hi, Bill. Now, I just have a question. I think I heard the same.
You have a lot of same component, like you have two kind of version message deployed. A single will make your operation harder. Why you choose two kind of same service?
Actually, to be honest, I don't think it makes our operation that harder, because I think we choose the package based upon the requirement of the problem that we're trying to solve. So, for example, we have used both brokered and brokerless messaging, because the brokered less messaging is much faster and allows us to transfer the images faster, but the brokered messaging guarantees us fault tolerance. So internally, you know, for task processing, we want to make sure that we don't think that we're actually doing some processing, but it's not, right? So in that case, the requirement for fault tolerance and persistence outweighs the fastness, right? But we use a fast library in order to send images fast. So it really comes down to what the requirement of the problem is.
The best one to lose some data?
It's not that it loses data, it's that because it's not brokered, which means if, so a broker is someone who sits in the middle, right? If I want to send a message to you, I can send it directly to you, or I can send to a broker, right? Say him, right? If I send to him, the great thing about broker is that if you're not there to receive, let's say I'm calling you, right? Let's use a phone example. If I call you and you don't answer, then I get your voicemail, right? Your voicemail is your broker, right? But if I leave a voice message, then you'll eventually get the message, right? I can guarantee delivery that way. But with the broker list, you have to be connected to me right away for you to get it, right?
Oh, 那我们掌声谢谢一下 Michael 先生。